Live from FedEx Forum in the American Home Shield Studio, this is the Chris Vernon Show on GrindCityMedia.com, presented by Direct Auto Insurance. Now, here's your host, Chris Vernon.
Noon on GrindCityMedia.com. It's Chris Vernon Show. Welcome, 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 welcome. It is the Monday, November 4th, 2019 edition of the show. Today on the show, we'll have 10 things from the weekend, and what an unbelievable weekend it was in Memphis with College Game Day being here and the Tigers getting a win. We'll talk about what the Grizzlies had over the weekend and what they've got going on tonight. NFL and the college and impressed and depressed. We've got a ton of stuff to get to. It's nice outside. Smile. Let's do it. Turn it up! Having a good day. My goodness, what an unbelievable weekend it was. And then it got very strange. I don't know. We didn't speak on this on Friday. And I guess I just, I don't know. I did not acknowledge it, hear about it, anything until I woke up on Sunday morning and I looked at my phone. And my phone said, and I went to bed late Saturday night because we had the Grizzlies and the Suns game. And then I went home, and I was listening to it on the way home. And then I got home in time to watch the end of the Memphis SMU game. My goodness, that game took forever if I got home for it. And so then I was up, right? And I'm all hyped up. And we had to stay on and do the post-game show. So I got all those lights beaming down on me. Like, I'm already kind of amped up, and then the Tigers win, and that's so exciting. And next thing I know, I'm up until, I don't know, past midnight. And I had gotten up very early on Saturday morning. And so anyways, I woke up on Sunday morning, and I grabbed my phone, and it said, like, 6:05. And I was like, what? 6:05? I was like, no way. I was like, I wasn't like dead, but I was like, why is it 6:05? And like, you know, the dogs licking my face and whatnot. I had absolutely no idea it was daylight savings. Like, I didn't hear anybody mention it. All I was concerned with was like all this stuff we had going on in sports over the weekend. I had no idea it was daylight savings. And let me be the first to tell you, I detest it. Yesterday at 5:30 when it is pitch dark outside, that is not the right thing. I'm not down with it. So while everything was awesome over the weekend, that took me by massive surprise that yesterday everything got a little off, right? And then for these next couple of days, everything does feel a little bit off timing-wise. But leading into that was an unbelievable weekend, and Saturday morning filtering into Saturday night was absolutely incredible. We have got a ton to talk about today. Let's start. Well, before I get there, I'll welcome John Roser to the show. Who's John? She's John Roser, a.k.a. the Cologne Ranger, a.k.a. the Body Spray Bandit, a.k.a. Senor Sack, a.k.a. Johnny Mac, Bull, Johnny Bear Cat, a.k.a. John Snozer, the Grim Roser, John Hustle, Johnny Asparagus, Johnny Neckharp, John Falcon, John Hustle, which today was Memphis Hustle Media Day. I went down there because I figured they would have the broadcasters speaking to the media, and I wanted to be there.
No, you didn't.
For John Hustle's press conference.
No, you didn't.
And instead, I listened to Josh Jackson, when really I wanted to hear what John Hustle's thoughts about the upcoming season were.
You knew I wasn't speaking. They should have us, though. We should be speaking.
A conference call, at least. Much like Reese Davis and Kirk Herbstreit did on Friday.
I mean, it's just
in preparation for game day.
I mean, the Hustle season opener is almost just as big of an event.
Friday night, they play the Texas Legends. Watch out, because it is on starting Friday night for the Memphis Hustle. The microphone mangler is also here. He is Devin Walker. He is Senor Quasadilla. He is Captain Observant.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And he
is fired up.
Is the man that owns Riley Patterson an apology.
Oh, I do.
And I own Brady White one. Yeah. And we all
it's an apology show.
We all owe somebody an apology. Let's get to it. This was incredible, to say the least, over the weekend.
Ten things.
Number one. Okay. Whatever my expectation was for College Game Day being in Memphis and what it would be like, I am here to tell you that it exceeded it 1,000-fold. I guess I had envisioned kind of what it would look like down on Beale Street, what a show would look like when they were talking about Memphis things. But I'm not trying to be hyperbolic here. Seriously, like 1,000-fold. It was better than I would have ever imagined that being. I'm talking about the scene. I'm talking about the setup. I'm talking about how it looked on Beale Street. I'm talking about how they were putting on Ja Morant and Jaren Jackson and Penny Hardaway and Jerry Lawler, and that they were talking about Memphis, and they're doing the story on Kenny Gainwell, and they're bringing Mike Norvell on. And I mean, it was just 100 out of 100, really. Like, it was so crazy. And I had said on Friday that I kind of gotten guilted in the morning, like, hey, you've got to go to this thing. And I told you my son had his last football game on Saturday morning, and that was going to be at 10:30, and it was in Bartlett, so it was going to be far away. So we were going to get down here really early and then try to, at the latest, get out, try to get out of the mix by 9:30, and then try to get out to where it was. And so early in the morning, on Saturday morning, you guys had started texting me. You were already down here. Mm-hmm. You had gotten down here by 6, right?
Yeah.
I was like 5:45, 5:30.
And so y'all had texted me pictures. You had seen our listener, Madison, she had the Vinnie Verno thing. She was already out there.
Yeah, she was, yeah.
By the way, just an enormous shout-out to her and her crew, because they got that thing all over TV. It was unbelievable.
Yes.
In the midst of a million signs, Vinnie Verno made his presence felt at College Game Day. It was amazing. I we could not have gotten a better volunteer. That was perfect. So anyway, the signs were great and everything, but you guys had sent me, and, upon your arrivals and sending me the pictures, I'm like, oh, no. Because there was already, hundreds and hundreds of people out there, and it's dark. The first picture you sent me, it is dark. You're like having to use the flash.
Yeah.
And so I'm telling him, like, I'm going to have to get him. It's cold. It's cold that morning. It did start to warm up, though. That was good.
No.
Yeah, it did. Yes, it did.
No. When the sun came out, it got colder.
No.
Yes, it did. everybody that was around me were talking about. Like, how did the sun come out and it got colder? Because when the sun came out, the wind picked up.
I guess it was just me. I wasn't that cold, to be honest. Like, I'm usually freezing cold. I wasn't this cold.
I was fine in the morning.
I was
when it was dark outside, I was fine.
Interesting.
It was weird. The sun came out, dude. The wind picked up.
Yeah, and there's no place for it to escape, so it just starts flying down that street.
Yes. There was a bunch of people, though, just like... You got a lot of body heat going on.
So, one guy had a sign that said, "I'm freezing."
So, I'm watching everybody on there because I flipped it on because they're doing the cut-ins on SportsCenter, right? So you can already, and they're showing like the scene, and I'm like, "Where am I gonna stand? Where am I gonna put him? Yeah. Where am I gonna go? How are we gonna get through that crowd? How are we gonna be able to get out of there?"
Yep.
I'm like, "Buddy, I think we're just gonna watch this thing on TV because you know I said this." When you and I debated on going to the draft in Nashville, and then when I saw it on TV, I was like, you cannot give me more anxiety.
Yeah.
I am not crowd guy. I am not. I am, like, if you know, I mean, you've been to, I mean, there's no telling how many Memphis football games you and I have been to together, Roser. And for many, many years, tickets were inconsequential, right? Like, you just had to get a ticket to scan, and then you just walked in, and nobody ever checked your ticket. And where did I sit? Where do I sit?
We always sit away from people.
I sat in the very top corner of the end zone for almost every Tiger football game. I'm talking 20 rows away from everybody. Not because I don't want to... Right, like, be in the mix with all the people, or that I don't want to talk to people. It's, I hate crowds. I hate being crowded. I would rather be a little farther away and just have my own space, right, where you can sit here and you don't have to sit right next to me on the bleachers, and I just can't stand. And so something like that just it makes me paranoid to see it. Like, that's why I stopped going to Memphis in May. Because I just...
You still like to be...
The last time I went to Memphis in May, the true story, I walked in and I was trying to make my way towards the stage and I turned around and I walked out. And I did not stay. I had a ticket to get in.
Because there were so many people.
I couldn't walk. I was like, I'm not going to be able to get a drink. I'm not going to be able to go to the bathroom. I'm not... Like, this... All of this makes me so uncomfortable. I'll just watch them perform live on YouTube. You know,
see, I'm the opposite. I love crowds like that.
So I can't stand the crowd.
I love it.
I don't like it. And so, anyways, I stayed home and I watched it. So I was watching the television broadcast and it was awesome. Like, it was a 3-hour commercial for Memphis and the city of Memphis and Memphis football.
Yeah.
It was so great. It was so great. And then after I'm leaving game day, I'm taping the rest of it because we've got a bolt at whatever, like 10 o'clock, and then go to his last football game. He throws, like, I think 4 touchdowns. He should have had 6. It was his last game. A year ago, he could not throw. Like, he couldn't – if you were standing, like, right there, he could hardly – throw it to you. It wouldn't have been a spiral, and it would have made it to you, but one of them would have gone to your right, and one of them got... You'd had to move to get to it, right? And he said to me, he was like, "I'll never get to play quarterback. I can't throw good enough." And I was like, "You just have to work on it. If you want to stand out here and you want to throw, throw every day." And every day he has asked me to throw. Every day. I'm talking no matter what. And he got to where he could really whip it. And then the last game of the season is how his game starts. This is after we left game day. He's got this kid, Rohan, on his team, and they run this play. It's their third down. They have to turn the ball over if it's fourth down, right? So it's third down. They're like third and goal, right? It's a pass-only situation. You can't run the ball if you're in this situation in their league. And so they run this little flank. Rohan hikes the ball. He's the center. And then he takes off to the side, towards the end zone. And he throws it, like, right at his feet. And I walked over to him and I said, "Now you listen to me." I said, "Number one, what was that?" He's like, I don't know. And I was like, "Bro, if you think I have stood outside for a year, I have the strongest arm for someone my age that is not in the NFL, I will put my arm. I could throw this thing now all the way across Beale Street from where we are right now because I throw a football every day of my life. It's what I do. And I said, if you think I have gone outside throwing with you every day, for you to throw a ball 4 yards into a kid's feet, it's your last game. What are you doing?
Oh, man.
And he's like,
hype up.
He's like, I don't know. Like, usually I would figure he'd say it slipped or whatever. It didn't slip. It's just a terrible throw, right? And he went back out there and went the hell off. I don't think he had something that didn't hit somebody in the hands the rest of the game.
Yeah.
And could have thrown probably 5 or 6. He ended up, I think, getting 4. And so that was amazing. We leave there, go back. 11 o'clock game stinks, so we watched the rest of game day. And so we watched the rest of it. And you want to talk about laughing? We were laughing. I can't remember the last time that both of us were watching something. I didn't know what had happened on game day, and we both broke out laughing hysterically. Bro, when Corso threw that pouncer head,
dude,
that was the absolute funniest
hilarious
thing.
Hilarious.
It was such great theater because he takes it,
yeah,
and he throws it, and everybody's like, you can hear this gasp, like, and then you hear, yeah, and he puts that stupid-ass horse head on.
Yeah.
That was so funny. We were laughing so hysterically, man. And we were like,
it was
so
fun.
So funny.
I was right there on the stage when it happened, and it was just like a big swarm of like, yay! Because he already had the
yes
Elvis suit on.
Yeah.
So like, yeah, he's going to pick
and
up.
And he's like, and how can I go against Vegas?
Yeah.
And he's yeah got him hovering it over his head only to chuck it. What the funniest thing ever. I loved
that
it.
That was great.
I loved it. All right, so you were unbelievable down here because you got crazy amounts of content.
Appreciate you.
You really did. You were here very early, and you chronicled all this on Grind City Media. You got some pictures that you put on your own Devin Walker account, but you had to go chase down Jaw and Jaren.
Yes.
Because they were going to be on game. Okay. Pollock.
I heard this. I heard it was awkward as hell.
It was terrible.
It was bad.
It really was.
Was it just awkward?
Yes.
He did the whole "you're tall, let stand up" thing.
You could be a quarterback, and yeah, I mean, boy, you'd be a great receiver because you're so tall. And it's like, and they had told them like Pollock's a huge hoops head. He's
yes
got a basketball goal in his backyard. You know, he can really talk hoops with you. Like, bro, they didn't talk any hoops.
Yeah.
It was just.
Well, it's just like Pollock didn't really prepare for it.
Like, no, right.
Like, Ja had a joke that Tom Rinaldi had told him to say.
Yep.
The segment was so short, he didn't even get to get it out. Like, Ja was like, I didn't even get to get the joke out afterwards. He was like, man.
What was the joke?
It was like, so you're a big hooper or some. Like, it was supposed to be a hoop joke, but he didn't get to say it. Didn't get to say it.
Well, that's not a joke.
It was like it was something related to, it was related to Pollock being like saying like he's the best hooper on like the whole set.
Yep.
Like, so you think you're a good hooper? Can you beat us? Kind of like that kind of thing.
Oh, that would have been hilarious.
But it was something in that vein. That's not like the exact joke.
I think that's why. Yeah, right.
It was that in that vein. But
man, that's a knee slapper.
Well, the segment was so short.
When is Rinaldi's Netflix special?
I don't know.
Just stick to making people cry. He's
just a modern day George Carlin right there.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah. You just stick to making people cry, Rinaldi.
But
we don't need your joke tips. Oh, you think you're good at basketball? Well, why don't you play us, NBA players? That would be hilarious if you said that to Pollock. Bro, what? I'm glad they didn't get that in.
Yeah, but our guys wanted to, like, we're in like a little clubhouse before they went on.
Yeah,
they wanted to be out in the crowd.
Oh, of course, because like they're 19 and 20, and everybody loves them.
Yeah, they wanted to, like, yeah.
Hey, some of my friends got pictures with Jaren.
Yeah.
Yeah, they wanted to mix and mingle.
What's
with
better than being 19 or 20 walking around and everybody, you know.
Everybody knows who
loving
you are.
Loving
you. Yes.
Everybody loves them.
Yeah.
Everybody loves them. Like, they think they should have, like, a reality show.
When you don't get to do, and you don't get to do that if you're them.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? When are you ever walking through a crowd of a bunch of people that love you? All you do is get away from people when you're in the NBA. You put your hood all the way up and you hide.
Security pushes you through. Yeah.
Security pushes you through. There's always 5 guards, you know, as you get off the bus, you know. telling people to get away. You know that guy? You know that guy Marty, who's been a listener forever for us. I seen him downtown on Friday. Oh, and that's the other thing. The other reason why I didn't go down there, my kids went down there all Friday afternoon.
Yeah.
So they went up on the game day set. They went on the where John Jaren were, that Pizza Hut thing. They got their pictures taken there. They went and saw the bus. So, I mean, they saw all the game day stuff while it was here, which was a cool experience for them. And anyways, what I was saying directly before that. Oh, I lost my train of thought.
It was the John Jaren and then...
Yeah. What was Pollock. I saying?
Pollock, John, no. Pollock messing up the John Jaren thing.
It was something about security. Anyways, those kids, they were walking through that crowd. They are never really in that particular instance. Oh, the guy that listens to the show, Marty. That's where I ran into.
Okay.
So he's big autograph guy. Anytime a visiting team comes to town, he goes. He's a collector, right?
Yeah.
So he's always got a backpack, and he'll have like a, you know, somebody will be walking by, and he's got an 8x10 photo, and he wants it to sign or a card or whatever. He's a huge collector, right?
Yeah.
So he had this 8x10 photo of Desmond Howard. And he said, like, you know, he's just walking, and then he had like a security guy with him. And he was like, Desmond, you know, could you sign this for me? He was like a Michigan, you know, pose one or whatever,
right? Yeah.
And he's like, hey, welcome to town. Glad you're in Memphis. You know, is there any way you could... And Desmond Howard just like kept on walking. He's like, and I walked alongside him for like 20 yards, like figuring he just like didn't hear me or something. And I was like, you know, I was like, Mr. Howard, you know, is there any way you could sign this for me or whatever? And he's like, he never acknowledged my existence. And he was like, that like never happens. It never happens where somebody just puts their head down and acts like you don't even exist.
Yeah.
Like, it's not like people haven't told him no.
Yeah.
But like, it's worse than saying no. You know what I mean? It's worse than saying no. He's just walking past you, like acting like you don't even exist, like you're not even there.
Apparently he's a apparently Desmond's a big vinyl guy.
What?
Yeah. He collects vinyl.
Oh, is that right?
And so, like, yeah, he was asking people from Memphis to hit him up on Twitter. Where's the best vinyl places? So he went to Shangri-La and went to Garner.
You know what? He's not a big autograph guy. Evidently.
Well, if it was probably that Heisman pose he did, he probably saw it and was like, I don't want to sign any more of those.
He's like, I'm not getting a cut of it anyway. So all that sign.
I get it, but not even like looking at somebody.
No, not even acknowledging the person is.
That's worse.
That's like, worse. Because I'll never forget when we were over at the old studio across the way right there above Alfred's and Wet Willie's and Dyer's, and I'm sitting out there, or maybe I was walking over, I was on the Forum Concourse or whatever, and Kobe Bryant was walking out after shoot around for the Lakers, walking back to the West End, and there is a grown man in a freaking like Lakers hat with like 24 on the side of it, Kobe Bryant jersey. Full Lakers warm-up pants, and he has his autograph out, ready to go. And Kobe goes, nah. And just keeps walking.
Oh, man.
Kobe told him no. He just goes, nah.
Yeah, you better say no, and somebody just not, like, treat you like a ghost.
Like, I know. No, that you're walking alongside him, and then never even, like, look over.
Yeah.
At some point, you got to say something. Be like,
hey!
Like, just leave me alone. Can you at least say that?
Yeah, dude. That's when you just got to pipe up and be like, hey, Desmond!
Sign the damn...
Mr. Hell!
Will you sign the damn picture? I mean, seriously. Yeah, freezing out. Yeah. Freezing out here. I came to meet you.
Well, did he say he also had a security guy with him? So if you probably like piped up and got real loud.
Yeah. I got tackled.
Security might tackle you.
Can we send a shout out to the guy that was selling beanies on the street?
Oh, my God.
At 5 a.m. in the morning.
I mean... What a hustle that
That's
is.
That's a big hustle.
That's amazing.
Oh, no. The other hustle.
Official Memphis Beanies.
So, Devin, you've probably seen this guy.
Were they really?
No.
The guy on Beale Street.
Bootleg? Did they have a letter missing?
Is
that the logo on there?
The guy who sells flowers up and down Beale Street on Saturday nights.
Yeah.
Well, he was doing that bright and early Saturday morning for game day. People were going to want to buy roses Saturday morning.
But they're buying them. Yeah, shout out to everybody.
Somebody probably did buy them.
All right. So you were in Alfred?
Yeah, I was at Alfred's.
Yeah, I saw Roser for a little bit. I saw him one time, and I didn't see him again.
So you couldn't see anything?
Yeah, I could see.
What could you see?
I could see the set. You have to get like right up on the railing of the lower level patio.
Which you weren't.
Yeah, no, that's exactly where I was.
The whole 3 hours?
It's exactly where. No, not the whole 3 hours. Because I moved out and we let other people come in and see. Yeah, because we had a big group with. There's a big group of us.
So you could see it from the side?
Other people, yeah. So I could see it.
Yeah, I saw Rogan.
But it is like, it's tough to hear. Yeah. It is hard to hear. Because it's not like they just have speakers up and down Beale Street blaring it. They didn't have that.
Right.
So
yeah, I was in the mix. I was like in the mix, in the little set. So I could like hear.
Also, from all accounts, insanely well behaved.
That I told somebody that too. I was like,
right?
There's no fights. Like,
yeah, usually
I did not see a fight.
Usually, I mean, look, you just put all that many people in that area, and you know a lot of them started drinking entirely too early. You're gonna have the irritable guy yell, no F you, and next thing you know, there's a freaking fight.
They started drinking the night before.
Yes.
I wish I could remember their names. They're probably glad I don't remember their names at this point, but they stopped me inside Alfred's. Like I went to pee, came back out of the bathroom. They're like, "Roger," and I was like, "Yeah, what's up?" And they're like, "Dude, big fan of you, Inverno, Snowman.
Uh-oh.
You're huge fan." No. I take it back. I did not get there at 6 a.m. I was down there at 5 a.m. because this is how I remember this. Because these dudes were annihilated. And I looked at my phone when I left, and I was like, when they're done talking to me, I was like, "All right, man, you guys enjoyed?" They're like, "Yeah, you too." I look at my phone, I go, "It is 5:27 in the morning, and they are annihilated."
It was a long day.
5:27 a.m. They were hammered.
It was a long day because, like, even speaking of the long day, my buddy Byron went to the game, like, with this big group, right? And he said, he had to park over at Toby Park, right?
Yeah.
And he said, you know, they stayed for the whole game to the end and then, you know, took their time leaving. And
right.
That's a hike.
Yeah.
Once you leave over across Toby Park, whatever. And they were past it, right? And he said he got back out there and it was like his car and like one other car was like out there still. Like, I guess other people had left or whatever. They had filtered out, whatever. Yeah. And he said, he's like, "It's my car and this other car." And he's like, "And the car next to us, two people are screwing in the car." There's two people screwing. He texts me. He said, "There's two people screwing in this car and my car at Toby Park." I was like, "Well, it's a big win.
It's a big win. You got some babies, man.
It's a big win."
Yeah. Getting excited, right?
And I was like, they've probably been there since game day.
Yeah.
And they were finally like, "You know what? Let's not even wait to get home.
let's do
this right here at Toby Park.
Commemorate this day."
That's like some Buffalo Bills stuff, man.
Unbelievable.
You see this video from like Bills tailgates, man, where like people just going at it in the tailgate area. Like,
terrible.
Like just, but not in the car. They're like outside the car doing it. Yeah.
Yes, yes.
Like some Buffalo Bills stuff.
Number two, the actual game.
Oh, boy.
Holy mackerel. All right, number one, the game was forever long because I went to the Grizzlies, covered the game, did an entire post game, took my time leaving, left, drove home, and was on my couch to watch the end of the game, which is unbelievable because that game started at like 6:30, right? I mean, it was easily 10:45 before that thing was all wrapped up.
Yeah, it was
a
super long game.
Yeah, super long game. And Antonio Gibson, who, if you recall, about a month ago, Norvell came on with us, and it was right after the first we saw of Antonio Gibson. And I was like, "Who is that?" And he was like, "I have got to find ways to get him the ball, because he is a big-time playmaker, and we've got to get him the ball more." Well, I guess they got him the ball.
A lot.
6 catches, 130 yards and a touchdown. 3 carries, 97 yards and a touchdown. 386 all-purpose yards, because he had a kick return also.
Yep.
And his rushing touchdown is one of the great college football plays of the whole season. How he broke those tackles and then stayed on his feet.
Bounced
and then
off
and then after you're breaking those tackles, that should take something out of you. You know how damn fast you've got to be to run past everybody at that point? You've been slowed down twice. You had to make a move, and you had to literally break a guy that was hugging you from behind. And he still beat everybody down the sidelines. He is awesome.
So
what a talent.
Special, man.
So what a talent.
So I was, this was last year.
What's his backstory, by the way? Look that up.
JUCO.
Yeah, JUCO.
From where?
Georgia.
He's from Georgia.
He's from Georgia. So was he gonna go somewhere big? Well, so this is so I get to this. So I was at the Liberty Bowl last year for a Tigers game, and it was the beginning of the year. So they're playing. I mean, I don't remember who it was, but I think we were like getting a beer or a cocktail or something. And like the line was taking forever, and I mean, this dude, he's like, man, what is taking so long? I'm like, dude, I'm thinking the same thing. They're talking. It's Antonio Gibson's dad. He's and because he told me he's like, man, I drove all the way from Georgia for this game. I was like, why did you drive from Georgia for this? And he was like, my son plays on the team. And I was like, who's your son? He says Antonio Gibson. I was like, oh yeah, 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 JUCO kid. He's like, yeah. I was like, so I was like, why did he go to Memphis? Because like he apparently he's a really good player. And he said to me, I told him to go to Memphis. Said he wanted. He was recruited by Dan Lanning, who Kirby Smart hired away from Norvell's staff. Yeah. And he said Lanning wanted him to go to Georgia with them, and Georgia was going to take him too. Kentucky also offered him. West Virginia offered him.
Yep, West Virginia offered
him. Yeah. He was offered by who was some other? Colorado offered him.
Colorado, Marshall.
Yeah, Florida Atlantic, Troy. But like West Virginia, Kentucky, Colorado, those are Power Five schools. And that Dan Lanning wanted him to also go to Georgia with him. His dad told him, go to Memphis. Like, go to Memphis. You will get to play there, and you will get your chance to shine.
I wonder if he's got – for goodness sake. There were scouts there, and he did that on national TV.
So yeah.
You wonder.
Because he knew Memphis threw the ball. He knew Memphis threw the ball, and he worried the Georgia – man, you got super talented.
DeAndre Swift.
You got super other talented, and they play conservative.
So I had two next to me, and I will tell you, when that run happened, they said, who is this Gibson kid?
Right in
like, and left.
Oh,
I'm not going to say the team, but they were like, dude, this Gibson, because he kept making plays. Like, they were like,
he was unbelievable.
Well, no, and it was much like whether it's Gainwell or like just whoever we see that's super fast, where it's like when they start running and breaking down, nobody is getting closer to them.
No,
like
he's the getting, distance is
the
getting
distance
greater.
Is growing. Yeah,
yeah. He was just awesome. And I'm gonna say this: Brady White was friggin' awesome.
He has been awesome ever since the Temple game. He's been awesome.
I went back and watched that. You know, I fast forwarded through all of the touchdowns, bro. He was dropping it in the bucket.
Yes.
I mean. Some of those throws. And he was throwing it downfield.
Yeah. The thing is,
I was like, what? You can do it, right? Like, clearly. And I don't know if it was – if he's just – he's got this confidence and swagger about him now where it doesn't feel tense. It doesn't feel like I don't want to throw a pick or I don't want to – he's just letting it go. Yeah. And, boy, he was accurate as all get out.
Yeah.
You know, look, that's the thing. Can – if you can get it in these playmakers' hands, I'll tell you this. It's not like you have to throw it and they've got to make a contested catch. He throws that thing, they are wide-ass open.
Yeah. Norvell, his offense, he gets his guys
well,
open,
they're
man.
He's trusting so fast, he's too. Got, and he's got – but they've got 3 yards of separation. Seriously.
Yeah.
Like every time. If you can put some air under it, they'll run under it.
Yes.
They are so damn fast.
It was one where Gibson couldn't get to because it was too much air under it. He was like, oh.
But if you do it, they will get to that.
Yeah, and Brady could have had a better day because that first drive where they ended up not scoring, Gibson was ended up being down like the half year. Magnifico on third downs. I mean, that ball freaking hit him right in the hands and he dropped it.
And the other thing, Gainwell's first, which they did not score on, that was a pass, wasn't it? I think it was a pass.
First drive?
No. The first almost touchdown?
Yeah, he got down to the 1 yard line.
When he that was off a pass,
yeah,
wasn't it?
Yeah, it was off a pass.
I mean, that would have been another one.
Yeah.
And they got stoned at the one. That was terrible. That was.
That was bad. That was a bad start to the game.
It's hard to be mad about scoring 54 points, but it's like, bro.
You're the 1 year old.
What are we doing here?
Well, that's the thing.
You got to punch this in. You got this whole crowd ready to explode.
Yeah.
But then they scored so quickly after they gave up the first seven that all's well that ends well.
We forgot about it.
Yeah. SMU could not stop them.
No.
Ever.
And you could tell, too, like, Norvell was like, man, let's we go fourth down. He was like, oh, we're going for it.
Yeah.
Like, fourth and seven. We got this.
SMU could not stop
them.
They were protecting Brady. He was unscathed.
Yeah.
So he had a good pocket to throw from, and their DBs could not.
That's the thing. They were playing like they put everybody in a box to stop Kenny Gainwell, and they kind of held him in check, but you could tell Brady trusts those receivers. He was throwing back shoulders. He was throwing.
Oh, man, you got Coxey and you got Gibson.
Hey,
you better trust them.
Let me tell you this one. This is great. When I was watching it back, because I'm scrolling through to trying to get all the touchdowns or whatever.
Yeah.
And so I'm scrolling through and I'm watching the different plays. So there is a play, anybody that – if you see this back, Coxey – he misses a play. Like, there's, like, a play the D-back makes on on a throw, right? On this, whatever it is, maybe like a second down. So now it's like third and eight or something. And as they are running back, he is yelling at that. He's yelling at the DB.
Yeah.
And as they line up on the outside, you can see him like saying, you know, I've owned you, whatever he's saying, yeah, right? Yeah. You can tell, you know that they're trash talking, right? And on this play, and you see them yelling at each other, and it's the one where he runs on the sideline, and Brady lofts it up, and he grabs it with one
hand.
Bro, he gets up. Number one, whoever is the sideline guy on SMU's sideline, who's the Memphis guy who, like, carries stuff up and down, like, I guess he's, like, holding cords or whatever.
Yeah.
He's standing right by, and he's like, oh! And Coxie gets up and is looking at their sideline and just woofing them. And the guy, the DB's like, what? Like, how did he catch that with one arm? Like, it was like he had just told him, I'm about to own you right now.
He's and one of those dudes, too, man.
Coxie?
He's built, like, he's one of those dudes. He'll let you hear about it.
It's left-handed, by the way. I don't know if he is left-handed.
No, he's not. I don't think he is.
I mean, that is a hard-ass right catch. He made it one-handed, left-handed, yes, down the sideline.
I don't know what it was about this game, though. Like, from the beginning, they had some different energy about the SMU. Like, I don't know if they don't like SMU. Like, I tweeted about it, like, in their huddles.
It's a weird team not to like because they've put 50 on them every game for 6 years.
I was in their huddles, and I've been down there for every game. And this is the first game where they break a huddle, and they say, F them. They were saying F, like, they were every position.
Oh, that's why you couldn't post the video?
I couldn't post the video. That's why I sent it to y'all. So I was like, I can't post this. They were saying F them. I was like, one of the people that work for Memphis, I was like, is there some, like, different energy with this SMU team? They're like, yeah, they don't like them very much.
Interesting.
Like,
I don't know.
They do not like SMU.
I mean, I was there for the Paxton Lynch game when he threw, like, six touchdowns on them in the first half. Like, they kill SMU every time.
Sonny Dykes said something about Memphis last year.
Oh, they did?
Yeah, so they don't.
Interesting.
Some different energy.
You know what? One of the things, too, when I was going through the broadcast and I was watching it all back, which is it's a fun game to watch back, especially when you can fast forward. Yeah. It is fun to watch. So many awesome plays in it. By the way, SMU has got – their receivers are so awesome.
Always.
Isn't that where – what's his name went? Cortland Sutton, that kid that's killing it now for didn't he go to SMU?
Cortland Sutton did go to SMU.
You're
going to
see some of these – friggin' guys in the NFL because they are.
Oh, and they didn't even have the Roberson kid.
No.
Who might be their best.
And their quarterback, Bouchel, could chuck it.
Yeah.
And their running back is awesome. They got some weapons, too. I'm watching them and I'm like, jeez, how about the run the kid made from midfield when they needed it, when they were down by.
Trug LeAndre Thomas?
Lord.
Oh, my goodness.
I mean, that was. Number one, he mows a guy. And then what was it? 60-yard run at least. Down the middle of the field, you don't see a lot of those.
He ran right over LeAndre. It was like a – and just
– and then just kept on running. And you want to talk about distance building. So they got mega playmakers on that offense for sure. So I gained a lot – I mean, look, that's one of those teams. Throw SMU against somebody, you know, like from a big conference in one of these bowl games. I love to see it. Let them play against one of these mid-tier, you know.
Like a Michigan or something?
No, let them play against like a.
Yeah, I don't know if you want to play Michigan right now.
Maybe not like a Michigan, but maybe a Michigan State.
Okay,
yeah. Somebody like that. Yeah. You know, I'm just saying.
That'd be a good matchup, Michigan State's defense against their offense.
Just let them play somebody from a big conference at the middle of the pack, big conference team, and you're going to see. That team is good. That SMU, offensively, their defense is not.
No.
But offensively, that team much
what, if we, like, what if we got like an SMU-USC bowl game
here's
or something?
Here's what I'm going to tell you. The Memphis team, I do believe this. Memphis can score on anybody. Jeez. There is nobody I don't think they can score on.
Yeah.
I believe that about SMU too.
Yeah.
The problem is neither of those two schools can stop you enough. They can't.
That's the problem.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I mean, but they will score. And if you'll get into a, right, like a score fest with them. You know, the problem is when you play like we did in the bowl game a few years ago, Iowa State, and they like they'll grind you down.
They hold the ball.
Yes, they hold the ball. You just don't get to touch the ball. But if they can play against somebody else that's like, all right, let's go at it. Let's go. Like, 'cause Sonny Dykes the same way. He just wants the ball back.
Yeah.
And then it's just like, all right, let's go. Your offense versus my offense. The rest of you, who even cares about that? In fact, if they didn't have to put the defense out on the field, they would never. Neither of them. They would just play the whole game
on offense
versus offense. You know what I mean? If they could.
Yeah.
But that SMU team is good. But in the middle of the broadcast, they did all – again, it was another commercial for Memphis. One of the things they did about the football program, which I thought was super cool, was they showed their facility, their locker room, the practice, for practices, right? Which are beautiful, beautiful. Looks great on TV. And in every locker – do you know about this? Have you ever been in their locker room?
Yeah, I have.
They have – each of them has a photo – in their locker. It's like in the middle of their locker. Mm-hmm. There is a big photo in the middle of their locker, and everybody's is different. And it is who are you playing for?
Yeah.
And so it'll be like, you know, Kenny Gainwell will have his brother, and somebody's got their family, and somebody's got whoever it may be, their grandmother or whoever it may be. But it will remind them every time of who they are playing for. Because he made them each come up with somebody. You decide, who are you playing for? And they all put whoever it is in the locker. I thought that was like super cool, and it's a super cool motivational tactic.
Yeah, Norvell's one of those guys.
I gotta find out where he got that.
He even mentioned like in the post game, he said, I always tell these guys, you'll always play for the name of your back, but down the line you'll always represent that front, that Memphis Tigers. And I was like, damn, man, that hit me hard.
And he almost cried.
He almost cried.
Yeah.
They almost got him.
He hit the choke up and the. Yeah. I was like, oh no, he's not crying. And he just said, he was like, it was amazing. Because he was talking about just the whole
little
day.
Little lip quiver.
Yeah.
Little lip quiver.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Shout out to Norvell, man.
Yeah, it was awesome.
What about, people have been talking about on Twitter about the refs trying to take the game away. They had like 15 penalties on like 200 yards.
Yeah, they did.
So.
They had a lot of penalties.
To do that and to win the game the way they did.
Like, well, salute. Look, it was meant to be. Right? It was meant to be. They couldn't take it away, like, to keep SMU undefeated.
Yeah.
Of course that's going to come up, right? You know what I mean? It's going to come up because, you know, anytime.
Yeah.
I mean, look, I do it with other conferences. Remember, who was it the other week where Oregon was playing somebody.
Oh, and
I was
I said,
it's all Washington, where they played Washington.
I was like, it's all they got left. You watch. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
They're really going to have to. You got to beat them twice because they got to protect this thing. These Pac-12, that's all. They got one team that could do anything. That's their standard bearer right now. So you're going to have to really whoop them because they are not going to get. You're not going to get a bunch of calls against them because they need to keep that team. I hate to think that dastardly, but it's college football. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And there's. Millions of dollars at stake.
Speaking of millions, did you bet on the game? Anybody bet on the game that you know, Roser?
Yeah.
It was 5-5. A lot of people got it at 5.5.
A lot of people got it at 5.5. It closed at 6.5.
That was the people that were pissed.
6.5?
It closed. By game time, it was 6.5.
All right. Well, I hate to say this. I hate to say this for people. Number one, the over-under for Memphis. This is what I text y'all. It's 37.5. I was like, oh, get out of here. 37.5. You kidding me?
That's easy money.
Embarrassing. You know what I mean? You know what their second half over-under was? I checked it. 17.5. They had 17 by the end of the third quarter.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. So, anyways, that play that Dyke, you know, they went for two, and I got a bunch of texts like, what the hell are they going for two for, right? And I was like, I love that. Like, I hate that it ruined everybody's spread.
Right.
But, look. At that point, you have to score two touchdowns, right? And if you don't get that, you can still tie this game by getting it the next time. To me, the good outweighs the bad by a wide margin. Wide margin.
Yeah.
Because now if you get it back, you can just score, kick it through to win the game.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? And you're not dead. You got to convert a two-point conversion. And by the way, their two-point conversion – like,
ooh, boy.
They could have scored 100 out of 100 times on that.
Yes.
Easy.
So they had a play ready to go. But just an unbelievable weekend for Memphis football.
Salute
the greatest.
Memphis.
Yeah.
The city, salute. Man. Everybody.
The best. Number three. All right. College football, impressed and depressed. Impressed. The aforementioned Oregon. Holy mackerel. They got down like 10-0. They scored 28 points like immediately. They won 56-24 over USC. And man, if you take away that crazy Bo Nix throw at the end of the Auburn game, they're undefeated and looking good right now.
Yeah, no, I will say for College Game Day, they made the right choice. They got the most entertaining game of their three. Georgia, Florida could not have been more boring.
Oh my God.
That game sucked. I mean, it was like that game like set football back like 50 years. Yes. I felt like I was watching something from like
so
1992 NFL or something. Like
so boring.
It's like Fromm dropping back, little play action.
So
play
boring.
Action looking down the field. Nope. We're going to throw it to the fullback in the flat.
Just two teams playing
2 and 3 yard gains every play.
Two teams playing defense.
Oh, yes. Boring. It was boring.
Oregon impressed me. Hugh Freeze has got Liberty at 6-3, and they won by 40 over UMass.
Dude, they scored, 49 points in the first half?
Yes, and then 14 in the third, and then 0 in the fourth. So they just took the foot off the gas. His quarterback, Calvert, 20 of 27, 474, and 4 touchdowns.
Woo.
I swear. Like, I remember, say whatever you want about Hugh Freeze. That dude could coach offense like nobody.
Yes, he can.
I mean, that dude had Bo Wallace holding every Ole Miss record ever. Bo Wallace?
Yeah.
I mean, who is Calvert? No one has ever heard of that person ever. 20 of 27, 474, and 4 touchdowns. They're going to be in a bowl, Liberty. Geez,
that's pretty cool.
They're going to be in a bowl.
Liberty.
Started off with him laying on a damn deathbed coaching the team.
Yeah.
Next thing you know, they're rocking.
They've got BYU, then Virginia, then New Mexico State. So they got to beat New Mexico State.
Wait, which
they've already beaten
New
Mexico State.
They're independent.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, they've already beaten New Mexico State once. They got to play them again.
It's the weirdest thing. They play the same team twice.
But this time it's at Liberty.
Oh, boy.
You don't go into
Liberty
Stadium and come out alive.
Nobody does. All right, I'm going to give another impressed. Jeremy Pruitt's got them rocking now.
They do look
They look like a real football team
in
Tennessee.
They do, man. Ever since that Bama game, man.
They have. Now, they've got Kentucky. Kentucky is a 2.5-point favorite, actually, against them.
If Tennessee wins out, they get the 7 wins.
Yeah.
Kentucky, Vandy, and what's the other one?
Missouri.
Missouri, I think, yeah.
The problem with Missouri is that it's at Missouri. If it was in Knoxville, that's just over. Like, we know Missouri's going to lose that game. They can't play on the road.
Missouri's not any good either.
No.
I think they can go 2-1.
It's since the Mississippi State game.
They just have to go 2-1, right?
Yeah, they can
split
go 2-1.
Next one, yes.
Even
next
though Vandy owns them.
They do.
Yeah.
If Derek Mason beats him again, they will all forget about how good they've looked.
Yeah.
And just hate his guts. That'd be the most Vandy thing ever, too.
Yes.
Wouldn't it?
The two games they win are the two ones where he spazzes and the biggest ones of the season.
Hilarious. If they were to beat Georgia and Tennessee.
Yeah.
No, Missouri.
Missouri and Tennessee, right?
But then they.
Yeah, Missouri. It's Kentucky, Missouri, Vandy.
Kentucky, Missouri, Vandy, yeah.
That's
the last
the order.
Three games for Tennessee.
No. But who did Vandy beat?
Who was that big?
They beat Missouri, right?
Yeah, Missouri. Yeah, Vandy beat Missouri.
He was like screaming like a crazy person?
Yeah, that's the one that we freaked out about.
Vandy football! Anchor it down!
Yeah. And they got their ass kicked this past weekend.
Yeah. Tennessee's really been different. The Mississippi State game, they won Mississippi State 20-10. They won that game. And that Bama score was 35-13. That final score is not indicative of what that game was. They got screwed by the refs in that game over and over again, too, Tennessee did. But they've been a totally different team.
Johnny Ball is really coming out.
They got screwed in that game.
Johnny Ball.
They got screwed in the Alabama game. I still don't think they would have won the game, but they got robbed a couple of times in that game.
Johnny Ball.
No, they've been a different team. There's no doubt they have. And they look. The
what's your over under?
6.5. I need him to win out.
Ooh.
I need him to win out.
Now he's really talking him up. He's believing.
Hey, I already hit the under on Arkansas.
Hey, look.
That was the easiest bet ever, Arkansas.
Vinny Verno had Guantanamo Bay leading them to victory.
Yeah. And that's the thing. They played conservative as hell and still, beat the crap out of UAB. It's 30-7. And UAB scored on, Tennessee's third and fourth string defense.
Also impressed. Now, here's one to watch. UCLA is now 4-5 after they killed Colorado, okay? They have won three in a row after starting 1-5. They have beaten, they won at Stanford, Arizona State, Colorado. So they're 4-5, so they got to get two more wins, right?
They got to get three more.
Two.
Three. Got over six.
Oh, you do?
Yeah, I've got over six wins on UCLA.
All right, they
got
to get two.
Two to go to a bowl game.
All right, look, now here's the thing.
They got Utah next.
No, do you know what the last three are? At Utah, at USC, Cal.
Yeah.
You can beat Cal.
They can beat Cal. They can beat, they beat USC last year. They can beat USC. Hey,
but that only gets them to four or five. If they got to win two to get to a bowl game.
So
they'd have to finish out 5-1. Chip Kelly.
They're scoring too, man. Like they're putting.
I would not have thought they would won these last three in the manner that they did against Stanford, Arizona.
Wait, you need six wins to get to a bowl.
Yes, and they are 5-4.
Yeah, they can. They're 4-5. They're
4-5.
That's what I meant. 4-5.
Yeah, they can beat USC. They beat USC last year.
It's at USC. They would have to, but yeah, they would have to beat USC and beat either Cal or Utah.
They could beat Utah.
If they
this
get
weekend.
One of these next two, they'll beat Cal and go be bowl eligible, I think.
They may be on our round robin.
The
Utah having a letdown after the big road win at Washington.
Oh my God! Why do you? I swear, every week is letdown, big letdown.
That's what he thinks.
They could. That Huntley dude has been unbelievable for Utah, though.
All right, here's depressed. This is going to be a weird one that I'm even mentioning this, but Boston College destroyed Syracuse this past weekend, and I am a big Dino Babers fan, and now I'm depressed that he did not find a job where he could leave for.
Yeah.
Because this is a damn disaster. They are 0-5 in the ACC. They are awful, and they have gotten rolled. They're 3-6 now. Like, they're going to have this bad season, and now it's going to turn on them. And Syracuse, like, had Clemson dead to rights last year. And Clemson demolished everyone, including Alabama. And it's all because, like, Dino Babers had that thing rolling. But, with schools like that, you're going to hit this high, and then, like, you're just not going to stay good every year.
Yeah.
You're just not, right? Unless it's going to take a long time to build it up. And usually people don't have patience for that. But I'm a big Dino Babers fan, so it's depressing to me how pathetic they are. And I'm like, man, I wish he would have gotten out of there. His quarterback is terrible.
And that's what happened to, what was it? Shiano.
Yes.
He was the same way. I just looked at what he was at Rutgers. He was like 11-2, 8-5, 8-5, 9-4. He went 4-8, and then he followed the 4-8 up with a 9-4 and was, boom, gone.
How about Mark Mangino at Kansas?
Yeah.
So they were 12 games and played in the damn Orange Bowl.
Yeah.
Kansas is like the worst program ever. You create your own monster, you know? All right, the biggest depressed, and no one's even close to this. Arkansas is absolute trash.
They are garbage.
No.
Woo, boy.
The worst.
Like, that Mississippi State team, like, doesn't even care anymore, and, like, they just murdered them.
At home.
Yeah.
At home. Kylan Hill, who is the running back for Mississippi State. You ready?
Mm-hmm.
21 carries, 234 yards, and 3 touchdowns.
Woo!
Oh, also, shout out to Chuba Hubbard. 20 carries, 223 yards.
Yeah, he's awesome.
Dang, he's a boss, man.
How many yards did the Mississippi State kid have?
He averaged 11 a carry.
How many?
234.
Yeah. Okay, it was 11 a carry.
11 a carry.
Yeah.
Okay.
Good God.
Look, Chuba had 20 for 223. A little update, by the way. Never got my jersey from that.
The website.
Foreign website.
Chuba Hubbard.
I never got his Chuba Hubbard.
I ordered that week two.
Wait, tell me.
What week is this?
It's like week 11.
Week 11?
Yeah, I think we're headed to week 10.
Never got it.
Wait, what'd you order from again? Cowboyjersey.com?
No, it was that one, that's got all the bootlegs on it. Oh. It's like an online flea market. Never got it.
Art Fire?
No, it's DH Gate.
Oh, yeah, I know about that.
I never got it.
You should try a Nike one on Artfire.
So just for point of reference, I never received it.
You're going to get it after the season.
I know. Chuba Hubbard. Remember, I ordered that Chuba Hubbard jersey. I never got it.
I need that. How much you pay for it? Like
$20? Yeah, $20. Okay, that's why I never got it.
$20 Chuba Hubbard jersey. Well, you can get one on Artfire for $33.
I'm done trying to get Chuba jerseys. All right, number four. NFL, impressed and depressed. All right, impressed, obviously, the Ravens are number one.
Let's go! Right,
we are not letting you become Let's a Ravens go. Fan. No, no.
Let's go.
No.
Why not?
Because here's the thing. Jameis Winston, Cam Newton, and the Cleveland Browns were all your top three. All of them suck, and you aren't allowed to just ditch them because they all suck
yeah.
and say, I'm a Ravens fan now.
No.
No. No.
Like I said last night in the group text.
And you can go back to our old ones, like week preseason. I am sitting here alerting you to become a Lamar Jackson fan.
The Browns were your team.
Look.
So you really can't switch to another team in the same damn division.
No,
like that is unacceptable.
Unless it's White Devlin.
Unless it's White Devlin, it doesn't play anymore.
This is my stance. I said, look, it's like test driving a car.
Mm-mm.
We've all test driven cars before.
No, I was test driving the car. No.
Now I finally found.
This is test driving three cars and them all breaking down.
Yeah.
And then you find a Ferrari and you're like, I like the Ferrari the best. Like, no shit. I mean, of course you do.
When your other option was like a Dodge Dynasty
that is driven off the road, like the wheel falls off.
Yeah.
You get the three wheel Taurus. You don't get the Ferrari.
Yeah.
We are vetoing your Ravens fan.
You had your chance at the beginning of the year to pick your NFL team, and when the Browns got Odell. You chose the Browns.
Yes.
And if you want to root for a black quarterback, I said Deshaun or Lamar. Because choose an awesome one.
Yes.
Because these are awesome ones. If you're just going to be, I won't root for a white guy, at least root for the awesome black guy.
Yeah.
Because you choose the sorry black guy.
Jameis Winston.
And it's like, what? Like, nobody, you choose sorry ones. No. There are awesome ones.
Lamar.
And I was even going to let you root for Dak and say, it's fine.
Yeah, I don't mess with Dak like that. I don't mess with Dak like that.
Yeah,
let's go, Lamar.
Oh, no.
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 No. No.
We have vetoed it.
My QB.
You won't get it.
Like, my QB. My QB.
The other one, like, and I'd probably hate you for it, but like, hell, man, like, root for Russell Wilson. Like, he's awesome. Mm. At least he's awesome.
And he's pushing baby future around.
He is pushing baby future around. But no.
He turned Sierra into a housewife, man.
Lamar's my guy.
Like,
no, he's not.
Lamar's my guy. He's,
no.
No.
He's
no,
wilding he's out not. On Instagram Live after the game.
No.
Let's go, my guy,
no,
Lamar Jackson.
Not your
no.
guy. You
no.
are not a Ravens fan.
No, if you're a Browns fan.
Nope.
You're
Ravens
a Browns
flock.
Fan.
We flock. That's where we go.
You're a Browns fan. That's what you are.
Also impressed. Tyreek Hill, House of Highlights Instagram that I sent you guys last night.
Yeah.
Might be the most insane thing
I
I've
saw
ever
it
seen.
On Red Zone in the middle of the day when they were showing highlights from it in Red Zone.
Oh, and he ran 22 miles an hour.
Yeah.
And he starts from a dead stop and somehow beats Damian Williams down the field, who is running away from every other player on the field.
Yes.
I'm like, how fast is this dude? And then you told me his Instagram is Cheetah, which is awesome.
That's so amazing.
If I was that fast, my Instagram would be Cheetah also.
Dude, he's so fast. Like,
Impressed also, shout out to Fitzmagic getting the Dolphins' first win. Josh Jacobs, 28 carries, 120 yards, 2 touchdowns for the Raiders. He is the pick, right? They got in the Khalil Mack thing?
Yeah.
This guy's probably going to win Offensive Rookie of the Year.
Yeah, well, here's the other thing, too. They've got another first-round pick coming for the Bears. Right now, that's slated to be the 10th pick in the draft right now. Now the Bears keep losing, it's going to get better than that.
I see very little evidence that the Bears will not quit.
Keep losing?
Not keep losing.
There we go.
not, you sound like me.
Struggling.
You sound like me out here.
Struggling.
Struggling.
Also impressed with Russell Wilson. He will turn anybody into a star.
He will.
Remember when we were like,
you are not convincing me DK Metcalf is that good. That dude runs in a straight line and he's really fast, but like, dude.
Do you watch them?
Yeah, when I say, I watch Red Zone, yeah, and they show a lot of them.
Okay, let me explain something to you. I'm going to explain something to you.
He is huge.
I'm going to learn you a little bit about football. If you are bigger and faster than everyone, which he is, He is good. he is bigger than you, and he is faster than you.
And he's stronger.
It don't
than
matter
you.
What line you're running in. You can run zigzag line. You can run straight line. You can run across the field. There's no line DK Metcalf can run in where he is not way bigger and way faster than. How are you faster than the corner? And he is also, that guy.
Strong as hell. Too.
Holy
yeah,
hell.
Yeah, he's really strong. He's
he is a monster.
Yeah.
And perfect quarterback for him.
Yeah.
I swear, Russell Wilson could like, I mean, I really think like you could put a thimble on something 60 yards away and the guy could hit it
with
the football.
I just really, like, dude, that team sucks without him. Oh, like, that's how awesome he is.
By the way, the only guy he ever, like had as his, like, safety valve and his receiver for, like, the last 7 years is Doug Baldwin.
He quit. Retired.
And it's like, well, who's he going to throw to now?
Tyler
and
Lockett, DK Metcalf.
He has turned into, like, the best receiver ever. Tyler Lockett is friggin' awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah. Super fast.
And it is one of those. It is one of those, like, the receiver, the quarterback can make the receivers.
Yes.
They are blessed to get to play with that guy.
Do we, I know I joke about Russell, but do we kind of underappreciate what he does because he is, like, he does it so consistently? Some people,
I have been terrified of him for years.
Let me tell you something.
He scares the crap out of me.
Because he's on national TV less.
Yeah, that's true.
He really is.
People don't even mention his name when you bring up, like, elite quarterbacks, like, just talking.
Well, I mean, he's been brought up this year because he is a legit, like, top three MVP.
But the afternoon game yesterday was there was Broncos Chargers, and then what was the other one? What were they showing on? Was there even a Fox afternoon?
It was Broncos Browns Packers Chargers, and then the Seahawks.
Seahawks
Bucks.
I always see Seahawks on Red Zone.
We had Chargers and Packers was the game here on CBS.
Yeah.
Yeah,
he's not on.
Yeah, I think he's one
the
of those
same
guys.
Way, right?
No.
Like Sunday Night Football, he's not on it.
Not on a ton. He's on Monday night next week.
He is? Who?
49ers Seahawks.
Oh! Rosie, you better watch out!
Man, I want to watch that game with Mercury Morris.
Yes, sir.
Man, it's actually a good thing.
You're the last undefeated, right?
Yeah. Yep. It's a good thing I can't watch that whole game.
You'd be too.
I got a hustle game. Hustle game that night. Yeah. I know. I'd be. I mean, not like during the hustle game. It's not like I'm not going to be checking my phone during timeouts and everything.
Depressed. I feel it's not.
The Browns?
No. Gardner Minshew.
No.
Oh,
poor
I feel Gardner. Like my guy's not going to get to keep his job. Bears. They suck. Trubisky. Maybe. Like, the in retrospect, that seriously might be the worst draft pick ever because they passed up Deshaun Watson and Patrick Mahomes.
I can't remember.
Like,
amazing.
Those guys are going to be – those are franchise-changing quarterbacks for 15 years.
Yep.
I can't remember who it was who told me.
A dud for two.
I can't remember who it was that said it to me. It may have been Elliot Perry. It may have been – I can't remember who said it to me, but they were like, this may end up being like Sam Bowie.
Like Sam
Bowie, like you passed on Deshaun Watson and Patrick Mahomes to take Trubisky, just like the Blazers passed on Michael Jordan to take Sam Bowie. Like,
here's the other thing, though. No, it's way worse to me because Bowie was injured.
Yeah,
that was what happened. Sam Bowie was an amazing college player. Mitch Trubisky was not. He wasn't an amazing college player.
No.
At all. He wasn't an amazing college player at
Deshaun
all.
Deshaun Watson, it's not like Patrick Mahomes was like.
He was still pretty damn good.
Yeah, I mean, he did throw for like 700 yards in the game.
He was amazing in Tech.
Yeah, they just didn't have a defense.
Deshaun Watson was amazing.
Bro.
How you watched Deshaun Watson and thought that he was going to be anything other than unbelievable is incredible to me. Incredible. The Browns are also depressing.
So
your team
and Odell's pissed.
Your team,
so
not
you,
my team.
Well, Odell should be because he's freaking on that 4th and 4 yesterday. Odell is flying down the sideline with his hand up. He's got Chris Harris beat, and Baker doesn't even look his
all
way.
Right, let me tell you something too. Let me just go ahead and say this, okay? Baker Mayfield has regressed and is not very good. But when he did, when, you know, he got all the love, he got all the commercials, he got all that kind of stuff, right? And he is also a very brash personality, so he gets at it worse than the normal failing guy does, right? Yeah. His stats are, in the words of Devin Walker, abominable. They are horrendous, okay? Yes. I think I saw yesterday, in fourth quarters, he's got one touchdown and six interceptions.
Oh, my
God.
In fourth quarters. That's winning time, right? That being said, I do want to take one quick moment to at least acknowledge, while they did not beat a bunch of winning teams and, they beat a bunch of winning teams and whatnot, he did set the all-time rookie record for touchdown passes. Like, that did happen.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, I do feel like it's not Mitch Trubisky. You know what I mean? It's not like he did. Like, that's not easy to do. There's a billion guys that have played as rookies. Yeah. He did not play all the games. Tyrod Taylor started at the beginning, and he did set that record.
Yeah.
So something did happen. Like, it wasn't like he has never shown he can do it. He did show he could do it.
Was it tape, you think?
And that's why everybody, you know, was onto him, and that's why all these companies were onto him, and that's why all the kids were liking him, and that's why everybody wanted the jerseys. And so I don't know what the hell happened.
It was probably tape, I think. Teams started to get more tape for it on you. They started seeing your tendencies over.
Well, the other thing, yeah,
they can't block.
They can't block.
They can't block. It shows everything. Like, it.
Look for the quarterbacks that do good. Look,
we goof about it, but it is true, and it's still true in football. We goof about it. If you can protect the quarterback and you can rush the quarterback, you can have a good football team.
You can put all kinds of people behind a great offensive line, yep. And they can make passes if you've got weapons. End of story. They can.
Yeah.
I watched Matt Moore do it yesterday.
Yep.
You know what I mean? That's not a demerit on Mahomes that Matt Moore can go out there and do it.
And the week before, he went like toe-to-toe with Aaron Rodgers for a long time. Like,
let me tell you something. Nobody knows this better than me. Nobody. Because people always want to jump on Dak and they say, he's just a, he's a nothing. You watch what he does tonight. Tyron Smith's playing, Lyle Collins is playing. Same as last game when they beat the brakes off the Eagles, right? And I found this over the weekend. When those two guys, left tackle, right tackle, right? When those guys were out. Now, nobody cares about that. Nobody cares that they're out. And nobody's ever going to bring it up. But they were against the Jets, okay? And they got beat against the Jets. And they were out another game. The games that they were out, the passing offense for the Cowboys, you know what it was? 28.
Ooh, man.
When they have been in, it is third. Third. Mark Cooper played, Randall Cobb, they got all these. They're there. Michael Gallup.
Yeah.
You can't do anything in 2 seconds. You know what I mean? And if you're always getting hammered and you're always having to flush the pocket and whatever else. Now, Baker, even when he does have a pocket, he runs away from it.
Yeah, he does.
Because now he's shell-shocked.
He is. Yep.
They can't block. They can't.
And everyone thinks Freddie Kitchens is in over his head, too.
Probably is.
And he might be. He might be. By the way, as we were talking about, you and you're trying to jump ship to Lamar, and we're not going to let you do that. You're going to have to stick with the Browns. Has there been a worse take, NFL take, than Matthew Berry at the beginning of the year?
Oh, my God.
That Odell Beckham was going to have the best season from a wide receiver, fantasy season from a wide receiver in NFL history because he'd been playing with Eli, and now he gets to play with Baker Mayfield.
It's the worst.
That might be the worst take that you could have in the history of football. That might be the worst take.
Let me look at Odell Beckham's numbers right now.
They ain't great.
No.
They're not great.
Not great, Bob.
Yeah.
Oh. Do you guys want to hear something hysterical while you're looking up numbers and you brought up fantasy? It made me think of it. So I'm in this DraftKings thing where these guys, it's a group of us, right? You've been in it before with me.
Yeah.
Everybody puts up $20, you pick your fantasy team. It's fun for the weekend, right? You can, if you win it, you end up winning $180 or whatever it is. Okay? So I do it usually every week just to have a daily fantasy team. William was asking about the daily fantasy team yesterday. And I was like, I've got this guy and this guy, but my team's doing crappy this week. And he's like, could I do that 1 week? Is there any way you'd let me pick a team, like a daily fantasy team? And he's like, that sounds fun. I was like, I got money in that DraftKings account. I'll let you do it. And he's like, okay. And he's like, do they do it for like just like afternoon games? because this is at like 1 yesterday.
Yeah.
I was like, they do actually have like ones where you but you only get to pick players from the whatever 4 or 5 games that are going on. And he's like, well, could I do that? And I was like, all right, let me check. See you at DraftKings. I was like, all right, I got I can't remember what I had in there. I had enough for – I did one – I said, what I'm going to do is I'm going to do one of those $10 double ups, right? So you know how those work? Have you all played them?
No.
So, okay. So, like, I pick a team, and it's 10 bucks to put in the team, right? So there's 680 people in the – 689 people in the contest, right?
Yeah.
So the top 345 teams win. $10. That's it. You just double up. You win $10. So now you win. You got 20,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
The bottom 344 or whatever it is, you lose. You lose your $10. So that's it. That's it. 689, whatever. If you're in the top half, you win. If you're in the bottom half, you lose. And so I gave him my phone and I was like, go ahead. It's $10. I was like, if you win, it's $20. If you lose, it's zero. Right?
Yeah.
I was like, you got 60 grand. You'll see how much they cost on the side. You know, if it goes red, it means you went over, whatever. He's like, okay. He goes through, he picks his team, right? So I'm out yesterday. He went to go to this basketball thing. And I'm like, oh, man, I need to check on his, see how his afternoon fantasy thing is doing, right?
But he's like, is he third overall?
The first place?
Bro, 15th. Out of 689. Wow. Now, keep in mind, I am in a contest this week. 12 people are in the group like that signed up for this week. I'm in 11th. Out of 12. My team.
Sounds like you need to holler at William every week.
This was his team.
You have an official ringer now.
15th out of 600. I was like, why didn't we enter like all the tournaments and everything? I was like, somehow he just picked players and had the best team. I'm like, do you know how much money is made off of people researching this and like coming up with lineups, or people pay subscriptions to get people's lineups so that they can try to win at this thing, and people make 600 different lineups for these things? He just made a team and got 15th. Out of 689. And I'm like, this is a joke. I was so pissed. I was like, I didn't even want to tell him. All right. You can see here. I just pulled up. It says $120. You can see the trophy on there, right?
Yeah.
And it says, he ended up 15th out of 689. He had Matt Stafford. Bro, this is so funny that this is the team he picked. Listen to the team he picked.
Yeah.
Matt Stafford, Philip Lindsay, Chris Carson, Marvin Jones Jr., Mike Williams, DK Metcalf, Jimmy Graham, Mike Evans, the Lions defense. And he got 0 out of the Lions defense and 5 out of Jimmy Graham and still got 15.
Yeah, DK and Mike Evans.
Yeah.
Mike Evans had 39 points. His big performers, yes, the ones he nailed were Marvin Jones had 29, DK Metcalf had 30, Mike Evans had 39.
All those hours of playing Madden.
Can you believe that?
All those those hours of playing
now
Madden.
Now you've really done it. So he has been down around me, watching TV with me, playing on his iPad, just around, all the time, asking me to go throw football, asking me to go outside and shoot a basketball, asking me to do this stuff, whatever. Well, you know, he's been playing Madden, and then 2K's been out for a while now, right? Yeah. So yesterday, I'm talking to my daughter, and there's like a kart racers game. It's like a SpongeBob game, you know. It's called Kart Racers. It's like Mario Kart, except it's all Nickelodeon characters. Yeah. And I was like, Haley, you want to go play it? I was like, I'll play you. And she's like, yeah, let's go, whatever. And then came the moment of truth. He says, oh, you're not going to be able to. I'm like, what are you talking about? I'm not going to be able to. And he's like, the controllers. Bro, the reason he's been around me and the reason he's been asking me to shoot basketball and throw football and he's playing on his iPad and he's watching all the same games I am and everything, He broke them both. He wouldn't tell me.
Because he got mad?
Yes.
He's broken control. Hey,
he broke. Hey,
you know you're official in that video game world when you started to break controllers.
Yes. It's been 2 weeks. Instead of telling me, I haven't noticed that he hasn't been playing these games at all.
Yeah.
Until I told her we'd go play kart racers. And then he had to fess up.
He had to tell
y'all
you.
Can't play because there are no controllers. And I was like,
because I broke them.
I broke the controllers.
Bro.
Did you say how?
He already had one that was rattling. Like rattling, you know, because he had thrown it.
Yeah.
But he had another perfect one.
Yeah.
And I was like, what happened to the other one? He's like, I said, you break that too. And he's like, He put his head down. I was like, you dumbass. I was like $60.
Wait, how do you... He just throws them?
Yes.
Against the wall?
Yeah. Or on the ground. He throws them on the ground.
I mean, I've like split one open before. Like a PlayStation 2 one.
The Hulk?
No, I threw it against a chair.
He takes it and he throws it into the ground.
Okay, yeah, I feel that.
That's what he does.
No, I threw mine into like a wooden chair and it just like...
I threw mine against the wall.
He hasn't been playing video games for 2 weeks because he broke them both.
With the controller.
That's hilarious.
It is hilarious.
Yeah.
That's what I told him. I said, you dumbass. That's $60. You better be awesome at DraftKings for like, 3 weeks in a row.
Like you gotta,
you better pick winners.
It's like you got to pretend to be mad at him, but it's also like,
yeah.
Hey, man, we've all broken controllers before.
This is what I told him, man. I was like, look, I have gotten so mad at a game that I've broken controllers too. I was like, but back then, controllers didn't cost them $60.
I was like,
these things are Bluetooth and expensive as hell. I went on Amazon, it's $60. I'm like, damn.
Everywhere.
Like, because no one really want a corded one.
Yeah.
No.
I'd rather not play. I'd have to sit 2 feet from that stupid thing. You know what I mean? All right, number five, Grizzlies weekend. All right, I'm going to keep this quick. The game was not good on Saturday night. I was glad John Morant was good in the fourth quarter. I have very little to say about the Grizzlies that's positive for that game. I have a lot to say about Phoenix. Let me tell you something. I thought their offseason was stupid. Ricky Rubio, Aaron Baines, you know, some veteran guys. Drafted Cam Johnson too high probably, who's old, and all this stuff. And you know, Tyler Johnson I like just fine. And, I mean, I like some of these guys just fine, whatever. But just didn't seem – it's nothing that impressed me, right? The team is, like, not going to be bad this year.
No, they're not.
They are not. They've got real players, and they bring real players off their bench. And sometimes there are guys that you sign that are underrated signings that have a profound effect, and I really feel that way about Baines. And let me tell you something. I don't know if it's not a little bit of a blessing in disguise that Ayton is out, because this is where it hurts them, because they go to the bench and they got to play Frank the Tank, or they don't have another big.
Yeah.
So that's where it hurts. But in terms of Baines starting for them and playing with them, like he is an advantage, man. Because nobody wrestles with Valanciunas, and he wrestled with him the whole time. And he, if you watch him on defense, he calls out every screen, and he is standing at the free throw line. His arms are always up. He's always in a defensive stance. Like, he shrinks the court.
Yeah.
He really does. He is a hell of a defender, Baines. And Ricky Rubio's good for them. And this is when you know they pass the ball to each other like crazy. For a team that just got, you know, hasn't played together for much, they pop the ball around, and they take good shots, and like Devin Booker just fit right in.
Yeah,
he's just playing amongst the rest of them. They all had double-digit shot attempts, and the way they play is so much different, and they're not just like an ISO Booker thing. And, you know, Sacramento sucks, and Golden State sucks, and here's what I'm going to tell you. They are not a Grizzlies peer.
No.
They're a Dallas peer.
Yeah.
That's the level they're on. So whatever level you put Dallas on, that's what you should put Phoenix on.
Yeah.
And they got more players I like. They ain't got Luka. Boy, your prediction is looking good, Roser.
Yeah, Luka's
showing. This dude may win the damn MVP this year. What's it? What are these numbers?
He had 35, 12, and what, 11?
Yeah, he's already had a couple two triple-doubles now.
What about his one last night? He was 15 and 14. against Cleveland.
Yeah, 15-14. 29-14-15 against Cleveland.
I mean, come on. That's a joke.
He's averaging.
That is a joke. That is.
That is amazing. He is averaging for the season so far 26.7 points, 10.3 rebounds, 9.5 assists, 1.5 steals a game.
On 47% shooting, 36 from three. He's lighting it up from three, man.
Unbelievable.
Hey, I was down Luka when he came into the league because I thought he was slow. He was slow.
He ain't slow.
He ain't slow.
No, he ain't slow. The other thing too is one of the
he's got the Harden thing.
Yes.
Step back. Deceleration.
Yes. And it's that step back.
The step
back. Dude, that step back, there is nothing slow about his step back. That thing is quick as hell.
Yeah. Yep.
Like when he moves back, it's like, dude, you cannot jump out on him.
His footwork, man.
It is.
So good. So good. He is fantastic. All right. We got to take a quick break. I'm going to burn through the last five on the other side. Chris Vernon, show.
Returns to Memphis for the first time in 2020 with Friday Night SmackDown. Friday night, January 3rd at FedEx Forum, you'll see Roman Reigns.
You must have not got the memo.
Braun Strowman.
Somebody is going to get these hands.
Sasha Banks. SmackDown Women's Champion Bayley. The Fiend. Bray Wyatt and more. Tickets available this Friday at high noon at the box office and Ticketmaster.
It's your boy Fat Joe here, world-famous rapper and world-famous direct auto insurance spokesman. Listen, I know what it's like to have money issues, but that didn't matter to Direct Auto. They'll work with you and get you the car insurance you need. You don't have to be rolling in the dough to get it going again. Go to directauto.com.
Get direct and get going. Save up to 25%. Direct Auto Insurance, Nashville, Tennessee. Rates apply. Discount subject to limitations, terms, and conditions. How you buy impacts cost.
Taco Bell Party Packs are now available for delivery. Nothing can stop us now.
What does everyone want tonight? Tacos! Tacos! Now what's gonna start this party off right? Tacos! Tacos! You can call us crazy, that's okay. We'll get Party Packs delivered any day.
Bring the party to your crew with Taco Bell Party Packs. Get free delivery on your first Taco Bell order over $12. Only with Grubhub.
Available at participating locations through Grubhub. Prices and items may vary. Tax extra. Delivery service and small order fees will apply.
When late night hunger strikes, get to Taco Bell. Your favorite melty, crunchy, grilled, spicy flavors like Nachos Bel Grande, quesadillas, crunch wraps, burritos, and more are all available when the mood strikes in the late night. It's the most delicious decision you'll make tonight. Fourth meal at Taco Bell. The best way to end the night. Sometimes you just gotta live mox. Hours of participation may vary by location.
Grizz Nation! Download the all-new, all-access, all-in-one Grizzlies mobile app. Get three new experiences with one app, including a fresh Grizzlies look and feel, along with new access to FedEx Forum events and Grind City Media news and notes on all things Grizzlies, football, and more. From podcasts to purchasing tickets, playing Papa Shot, and more, the new Grizzlies app has it all. So don't delay. Upgrade your experience and download the new Grizzlies app today. Available now at the App Store and Google Play.
The voice, the hits, the tour. The wait is over. Celine Dion, Courage, World Tour. February 9th, FedEx Forum. The first North American tour in over a decade. Reserve seats on sale now at Ticketmaster.com. Celine Dion. Produced by Concerts West. Get tickets now.
Welcome back to the Chris Vernon Show on GrindCityMedia.com. Brought to you by Direct Auto Insurance. Live from the American Home Shield Studio inside FedEx Forum. Be sure with the shield and go to AHS.com today for your free no-obligation home warranty quote. Now, back to your host, Chris Vernon.
We'll be right back.
We're back. Chris Vernon Show. Shows are brought to you by Direct Auto Insurance. And if you want to save a ton of money on your auto insurance, you probably can. Get a free quote today. Go to directgeneral.com, directgeneral.com, or call them 1-877-GO-DIRECT, 1-877-GO-DIRECT, and get your free quote today. Direct Auto Insurance. All right, let's knock out these last five quickly. We got a game going on tonight down here. We've had a busy morning with the Hustle Media Day going on, et cetera, et cetera. Back number six, Hustle Media Day. I was very disappointed that John Roser, a.k.a. Johnny Hustle, did not speak to the collected media to give a preview of the upcoming season. Saw the players walking through. They are big. They got a big team. And look good in the jerseys. And I like John Conchar, right? I like he's always he seems like he's always in a good mood, right? He's like got a good attitude stuff, obviously. My man Dusty Hannes is on the team. Matt Mooney, just a ton of white guys. no, they got
We got a lot of white guys.
Josh Jackson was great speaking to the media.
Yeah,
I will say that. Wait, Josh Jackson was great.
I saw Matt Mooney today. He was pulling up on a bird.
There he is.
Yeah,
there
he came. He came to me today on a bird.
Rainier Thornton, a Memphis alum.
Rainier Thornton on the team. Who was the guy that used to play so hard? Number 55.
Vanky. Vanky Joyce. What is his name?
Yeah, I mean, this is a terrible representation.
Yeah, Vinky. Yeah, Vinky.
All right, here.
Eastern Washington.
All right, oh, hold on, hold on. I have not looked at that. No, grab your roster.
Okay.
All right, I am going to me and Devin are going to attempt to tell you where they went to college, okay?
Right,
because I have not looked at a Hustle roster. In fact, I didn't know Rainier Thornton was on the team until this morning. I didn't.
Ooh, okay.
I knew that at least.
But they made final cuts, right?
Okay. Yeah.
And he made it?
He made it. Utah.
George Washington.
Jared Utoff.
Iowa.
Rainier Thornton.
Memphis.
Marcus Teague.
Kentucky.
He's on the Hustle?
Yeah.
Again?
Yeah, Marcus Teague's back.
Huh. Where was he last year?
South Korea.
Wow.
Came back. Kentucky, okay. Right?
Yeah, Kentucky.
Yeah, went to Kentucky. Matt Mooney.
Texas Tech.
John Conchar.
Indiana, Fort Wayne, Purdue.
Yeah, there.
Vinky Joyce. Or Dwa.
No idea.
I mean, I just said it.
Eastern Wash, Kentucky?
We weren't paying attention.
Eastern Washington.
Oh. The Redfield.
Same place as Rodney Stuckey.
They had the Redfield. Yeah.
Huh? Nino Johnson.
Lipscomb?
No.
Y Station High School?
Well, yeah, we know that.
Where did Nino play in college?
Wait, is it in Tennessee?
No.
Where did...
UAB?
No.
Where did Nino play?
I don't know.
Y'all look pretty good at this, though.
Illinois?
No.
Was it big school or small school?
Small school.
It's not Lipscomb. It's not in Tennessee.
OVC?
I don't know if they're in
OVC. Okay, just tell us. Who is it?
Southeast Missouri.
Oh, SEMO.
Yeah, went to SEMO. SEMO. Josh Jackson.
Kansas.
Dusty Hannes.
Arkansas.
And Texas Tech.
And Shaq Buchanan.
Murray. Brownsboro.
Benny Boatwright.
USC.
Ahmad Kaver.
Oh, Dominion.
Yeah,
Old Dominion.
Yep.
That's the whole roster?
Yep.
Hey, we only missed Nino.
You did good.
We missed the Memphis
kid. You missed the kid from Memphis.
All right, so now, John Hustle, while you did not speak to the selected media. We're down there. What is he out? We did run into my old buddy, Jason March, who's now the coach there. He's on Jaeger's staff for many, many years and was a video coordinator prior to that. That's Tony Allen's favorite guy, March. What is the prognostication for this upcoming season?
They're going to shoot a lot of threes.
Yes, and play very fast.
Yes, they're going to shoot a lot of threes and play fast. I worry about the rebounding and toughness. Nino's kind of the guy.
Now, do you...
Nino is kind of the guy. Like, he was that way at training camp when I saw it. Like, it was like no prisoners. You try to go to the basket on him, he's the one who's going to knock you on your ass.
Yeah. That sounds very insightful.
Yes.
Doesn't it, Devin?
Yeah.
Wouldn't you agree, right?
No, like over under or anything.
Which would
like
they played 50 games. I
would have said that was insanely insightful.
Yeah. Great analysis from
if that is not exactly what Jason March said to me when
it's true, though. Yeah.
I said you guys team, huh? And he said, we've got to figure out rebounding and toughness. And Roser just
No, it is. No, it is. It's what I said to him too. I said, "You got Nino."
He attempted to present that as original thought.
I said, "You got Nino."
Original content.
I think Yuta will average over 20 a game.
Oh,
no, there we go. Yeah. That's what I need.
I think Yuta's
and G League MVP.
I think Yuta's going to average over 20 a game.
Call it. Say G League MVP.
No, I'm not going to say G League MVP.
Friday night, if I go to it, every time he goes to the line, MVP, MVP.
I mean, you probably should come out there. It's either that or you can stay home and I know our bosses are going to be listening and they don't want to hear me say this. You can stay home and watch the Grizzlies get their ass kicked by Orlando like they do every year.
Oh!
In Orlando. We do, dude. Our yearly trip to Orlando is always bad, man.
What is wrong with
you? We always get killed. Every year we go to Orlando, we get killed.
I think Chandler played good there last year.
He did.
We don't have Chandler this year.
Oh, shoot. We could.
I know, right?
Just call him.
Has he played for Atlanta yet?
No, he's got bilateral knees.
dude, tell me you saw his tweet the other day.
No.
Oh, my God. Did you guys didn't see this?
No.
There were one of these hoop types or whatever.
I remember the one we tweeted, I missed the NBA.
No, they put up a video that said it was like the players that have made the most money per game.
Oh, I see it now.
And he was on the list and he put hashtag blessed. That's the Chandler I do like.
The petty one.
The very self-aware.
Oh, yes. I remember one of them where it was there was another one on Instagram.
On the list of the players that have made the most money per game.
There was another one that was on Instagram and it was like, man, I don't remember what it was.
Oh, it's Famous Lowe's. It was Famous Lowe's said.
Yeah, and someone was like, Chandler Parsons has only averaged like 15 points a game once in his career and got paid $94 million. And Chandler commented, $95
million. Yeah, it was Famous Lowe's that said that.
Yeah.
He's very self-aware how much money he makes.
All right. Number 7. Opening lines for a huge week. Bama 6.5 over LSU right now.
I thought it was 7.5 or 8.
Wonder what that number's going to be by kickoff.
I know. I'm going to let that thing keep
dropping. Especially
when
the Tua news, you know, comes out.
Oh, we only lost by 4 in overtime last year to Orlando.
Thank you.
Okay, not too bad.
He would remain a game-time decision.
Maybe we won't get killed there. Tyler Dorsey led the Grizzlies in scoring last year in Orlando with 29.
A couple interesting ones. Notre Dame minus 6.5 over Duke. I mean, talk about falling. What is that line 2 weeks ago? Like 20? Seriously. They're 6.5 over Duke? I mean, they got drilled by Michigan.
Yeah.
And then they barely beat Virginia Tech this past weekend. And now they're 6.5 against Duke. Penn State is only 6.5 against Minnesota.
Well, Minnesota's a top 15 team.
I know. But Penn State has been like
it's in Minneapolis. It's in the Twin Cities.
Everybody said Michigan State was going to rock them. Remember?
Yeah.
Penn State's done pretty good at beating people's asses. Baylor -1 against TCU.
I'm seeing the ruler. I've seen him mentioned with that Florida State job.
Well, that'd be a good hire.
Be a great hire.
Kentucky -2.5 over Tennessee. Wisconsin -8.5 over Iowa. I think I'm going to have to take Iowa because it's a 7-0 game. Wisconsin, Iowa.
Wisconsin's like favored by 8.5. Wait, neither team can score 8 points.
Right. Number 8.
Wait, we're not going to talk about Ohio State -44 against Maryland?
We weren't.
Okay.
Thanks for bringing it up, though.
Yeah.
Number 8.
Go Bucks.
I don't know if anybody else has ever gotten fired/cut because of Twitter, but Jermaine Whitehead has.
Shout out to him. All the threats.
He waved after his Twitter rampage yesterday. I will say this. I was unaware of Jermaine Whitehead's work prior to. I would also say that when I saw a Twitter rampage, that was a grand undersell. Because as I read, he was threatening to murder, like, everybody and even murder people in DMs.
Yeah.
He was really, like, it wasn't like a Twitter rampage, like, you know,
he wanted to kill one of like the team broadcasters.
Yeah, he did.
Yeah, and a lot of cracker.
A lot
talk.
Of cracker talk.
A lot of cracker talk.
And F called them F.A. cracker.
Yeah, a lot of F bombs, a lot of cracker talk, and a lot of death threats. That'll do it.
On blood, actually.
Yeah. On blood.
On blood.
And he posted his own address.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then asked, where do you want to meet up? And, bro, he told that one guy he was going to shoot him. And I said, you'd probably miss. I'm like, bro, there is nothing funnier than that. Because you know how mad he was.
Oh, yeah.
He's so mad about these tweets that he is to the point where he is threatening to kill another person. And the guy's response is, you'd probably miss. Dude. No. Just outrageous.
You'd probably miss.
Now he doesn't have a job.
Unbelievable.
I mean.
You hate to see it.
That's what one of my friends said. He's like, where he really screwed up is you can't just do both. You cannot threaten to kill someone and call him a cracker.
Well,
and put it on blood.
And
on blood.
Be horrible at a football game. Yeah. Like, he was so bad.
Dude, he got trucked.
That's why he was getting it so bad. I went and looked him up. He played at Auburn.
Oh.
Shocker.
He must be proud. Number 9. So, you remember we were talking about that Apple TV thing last week? Apple TV Plus or whatever, the streaming service?
Yeah.
So, it popped up this weekend. And I did buy it. I have not watched it yet. But it was elicited because, or the reason it came about is because my wife said, I turned on our Apple TV and it said, you know, get Apple TV Plus or whatever. She goes, I want to watch that Jennifer Aniston show with Steve Carell, the morning show.
Yeah.
You know, their original. Whatever. They have another original show that looks awesome that's got the guy from Aquaman. Whatever his name is. Jason something?
Jason Momoa.
Yeah. Anyway, I will say, when I scrolled through it, it looked pretty awesome. It's $5, and it's whatever. It's free for a while until I get they start charging me $5 a month. And that actually made me think as I was scrolling through there. Have y'all seen Aquaman?
No.
Yes.
Last Saturday, I have not. It's long. It's over 2 hours. I watched the first like hour and 20 minutes. About a week ago, on some Saturday morning, me and William were flipping around. It was just on.
It's not bad.
Dude, I loved it.
Yeah, it's pretty entertaining.
The first hour and whatever, the first part that I watched, I loved it.
Yeah.
I was not expecting to think that was cool, but it is so cool.
It was not bad.
It's awesome. I thought the first hour and 20 minutes was awesome.
I watched it when we were on the rest of it. I watched it when we were on the, I think, the plane to Vegas.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I loved it. I loved what I watched. And nobody told me Aquaman was awesome. I don't know. Nobody's ever.
I mean, I didn't think it was awesome, but I thought it was. I mean, it was good.
First hour is.
I thought it was good.
Action wise and storyline wise, I liked it.
Yeah.
I liked it. And he's a cool action hero.
Yeah, he is cool.
Number 10, what we got going on tonight? All right, so the Cowboys are playing the Giants. And I guess I'm just going to have to watch this on my phone. I've got to do the Grizzly game against the Rockets, who Russell Westbrook ain't playing tonight. Russell Westbrook's not playing tonight. He's got the Ja Morant flu. Grayson Allen's not playing tonight. He's got the James Harden flu.
Oh, my God.
I can't blame Grayson if that's the case.
Good to hear Jaren's okay. He'll be back hopefully by the end of the week.
He'll be straight.
And but Grayson has got an ankle thing. And so no Russell Westbrook tonight, no Jaren Jackson tonight. Is that a fair trade? I say yes. Jackson may be more essential to the Grizzlies playing competitive basketball than Westbrook, clearly, to the Rockets. So maybe it's not a fair trade. But look now, they got to score a lot. I mean, even if you pencil in, I was telling Rosa this earlier, even if you pencil in Harden for 60.
He's still got to find 40 more.
And that rat-ass Wizards team put 150 on him. So they don't care about playing any defense.
It's true.
That's the kind of team that the Grizzlies need to play. Somebody that doesn't give a crap about defense.
You know what? I'll make a prediction. I think Ja gets his first poster tonight.
Ooh.
I think because
Clint Capella?
The lane's going to be so wide open because they give you driving lanes. He's going to catch somebody tonight.
All right. So we got that. And the Cowboys, if they win by anything less than 28 points, I'll be disappointed.
Yeah, I mean, the Rockets are dead last in the – or 29th in the league in defensive rating.
How impossible it is to ever – be able to get that number down after you give up 159 points. Like, it's you gave up 159.
Yeah, it's gonna take a while. It's gonna take a while.
It was a regulation game too, wasn't it?
Yes,
it wasn't overtime.
They're never getting that number down.
That's
that one thing. It ruins it. It's like taking the 60 point loss Remember when the Grizzlies did that in Charlotte? Your point differential is never getting right.
Yeah.
It's just going to be minus 15.
You're screwed from that point on.
Yeah, you're screwed from that point on. All right, so we got a big night tonight. Make sure you tune in to Fox Sports Tennessee tonight at 6:30 for the pregame show. Me, Rob Fisher, Brevin Knight, Pete Pranica. Grizzlies Rockets.
You sound so excited.
Yeah, you sound thrilled. You sound like you definitely would not rather playing, be I home would. Watching Cowboys Giants.
I mean, what do you want me to do? Like, you only get 16 of these. You know what I'm saying?
I got 82
Grizzly games. And I just had one like 2 days ago.
You got four more this week.
I know. I feel like I feel like, you know, if another day passed, that'd be okay before I went to another one. I don't need to go to one today, especially with daylight savings and everything. Like, and I hate watching James Harden. I hate it.
Dude, we got a busy week, man.
Yeah, it's going to be a fun week. We got Tigers. We got
Tigers tomorrow. Grizzlies again on Wednesday.
I got a panel on Wednesday.
Is the Tigers a real game?
Yes, yeah. Tomorrow.
Dude, I just saw on that bottom line, it said number one Michigan State, number two Kentucky is tomorrow night?
Champions Classic, yeah.
Damn. Yeah. The freaking season kicks off with number one versus number two?
Yeah, and then it's Duke. That's awesome. And then Duke and Kansas play after that.
Yeah, but number one versus number two? Yeah.
To kick it off, that's big. That's big time. You might get to see James Wiseman tomorrow night, though.
Oh, yeah?
Yep.
Who they play?
South something. South Carolina.
South something.
South Carolina State. I think it's South Carolina State. Or South Carolina Upstate, yeah, something like that.
Yeah, one of those South Carolina something.
I think that's where Torrey Craig went, by the way. South Carolina Upstate.
Yeah, that's cool. So, yeah, we got a big week, man. Big week.
It's going to be a big week. That's for sure. We got what? Monday, Wednesday, Saturday, Grizz?
Monday, Wednesday, Friday, Saturday.
Well, Friday's not here.
Yeah, so Rhodey.
Orlando. Rosa. Yeah. I might have to go see the Texas Legends game.
Yeah.
Versus the Hustle. Or maybe, are they going to be on ESPN Plus this year?
I don't know.
You got one job, Rosa.
Yeah, I call the game.
Yeah, but you should be able to tell people where they can see it.
I'll know that by this week. At some point this week, I'll know.
Trying to plan my week, Roser.
You just come down to the game. Why don't you come down to the Lander Center and support your Memphis Hustle?
Get me a limo, I will.
Get you a limo.
All right.
You know Romeo from the Horseshoe. Call him.
He'd drive me straight down there and let me lose a grand.
Yeah, he would.
All right, we'll be back tomorrow. Until then, we go.
2 foot 5 foot 9. That's all I got to give to you. So don't you change your mind. I'm a fool. I'm a fool growing up. Yeah, but everybody say you gotta get there sometime. Gotta go out of my mind. And I try and I try, I try and I try. I'm a fool growing man. I'm a fool growing man.